Welcome to Global Connections with Robert Siegel, Navigating the New Normal, presented by the American Friends of Rabin Medical Center. Our monthly leaders forum addresses vital issues facing society and the economy, real estate and medicine, technology and science. My name is Dr. Joshua Plow. I'm the Executive Director of American Friends of Rabin Medical Center, AFRMC, a 501c3 national American charitable organization based in New York City. We at AFRMC represent Israel's premier hospital, Rabin Medical Center in Petah Tikva in Greater Tel Aviv, the leading institution named in honor of Prime Minister Yitzhak Rabin. The hospital is a model of coexistence as it serves 1 million patients annually from all ethnic and religious backgrounds with the same compassionate care. Please support our mission in this free public affairs program with a donation of any amount. Visit American Friends of Rabin Medical Center online and donate at AFRMC.org. Join us on social media, on Twitter, Instagram, LinkedIn, YouTube, and Facebook. We depend on our audience's support to help the hospital in Israel. So thank you if you can contribute any amount. Our host and moderator for Global Connections is Robert Siegel, former host of All Things Considered on National Public Radio for 31 years. Over the course of an hour each month, Global Connections features guests who Robert Siegel interviews as they explore important issues in our world. Today's Global Connections topic is Russia, a new Cold War? Thank you to our very special guest, Ambassador Ivo Daalder, President of the Chicago Council on Global Affairs and former U.S. Ambassador to NATO from 2009 to 2013. Rabin Wright of the Wilson Center and columnist at the New Yorker magazine. Dr. Kimberly Marten, the Barnard College's Political Science Department, and Dr. Donald Jensen, Director for Russia and Europe at the U.S. Institute of Peace. And now, Global Connections with Robert Siegel.
Thank you, Josh. We don't know how the war in Ukraine will end or when, but we do know this much. However Ukraine comes out of it, Russia will still be next door. And the United States, NATO members, and other countries will have to figure out how to deal with Russia and with its president, Vladimir Putin. Are we on the verge of a new Cold War? On what terms can Russia be welcomed back by its democratic trading partners? What should be the message to Moscow? All big, complicated questions, and we have a panel that is well up to the task of addressing them. After I interview each of our panelists, we'll throw the second half hour open to discussion and questions. And you can submit a question by using the Q&A button at the bottom of the screen. We'll start with the journalist on our panel, Rabin Wright, a columnist and contributing writer to The New Yorker. She's also a joint fellow at the U.S. Institute of Peace and the Woodrow Wilson International Center. Rabin has been writing about foreign policy for many years, and for just about every prestigious newspaper and magazine you can name, including a stint covering U.S. foreign policy and national security for the Washington Post. She has reported from over 140 countries and has done tours based in Europe, Africa, and the Middle East. And she's our first panelist today. Hi, thanks for being with us.
It's so wonderful to hear your melodious voice again.
Okay. I'm sorry you have to see me as well in this phase of my career. I'd like you to summarize, first of all, how we got to this point, how we went from being a country seemingly in search of a reset with the tough but seemingly popular leader of Russia to now being at the head of a coalition arrayed politically and economically against him.
Well, I think Putin has made clear for a very long time his intentions in terms of recreating Greater Russia, and his fear is almost paranoia about NATO. 15 years ago in 2007 at the Munich Security Conference, he got up and basically said, NATO has put its forces on our borders, and it represents a serious provocation. He asked why the West needed to deploy military infrastructure and troops along the border with Russia. So that's been clear. His aggressive impulses have also been clear, whether it was the invasion of Georgia in 2008, the invasion and invasion of Ukraine and annexation of Crimea in 2014. Beyond the region, he has been a major factor in the Middle East, notably in Syria, where in 2015, his forces were critical to prop up the regime of President Assad. And Russia now has established both a naval and an air force base in Syria near the Mediterranean that extends Russia's military deployment well beyond, you know, Europe. Mm-hmm. And so we've seen, and now the most recent intervention, this is, you know, this is part of a pattern. And Putin has made no secret of his ambitions to be the next Peter the Great and to expand Russia's influence and you know, what to absorb what he views as a country in Ukraine that is a nation of Slavs, many Russian speakers, that he believes is part of ancient Rus.
The U.S. and Europe have joined forces behind some tough sanctions against Russia. You've probably reported from every country that's been sanctioned in recent years. What's the scorecard on sanctions?
It's pretty poor. And when you look at what the United States has been able to do, it's, you know, it's broad, it's deep, it's multi-layered, but it also is largely the United States. The European Union still is buying energy, a lot of its energy resources from Russia. I heard a statistic today that the U.S. has invested $1 billion in the past 6 weeks in military equipment for Ukraine, whereas Russia has made $35 billion in that period from selling energy to Europe. So sanctions are limited in their impact. And just a couple of statistics, because I have covered sanctions since the 1970s, you know, in Africa and Europe and the Middle East. And we saw the first sanctions embargo on South Africa in 1962, but Nelson Mandela didn't walk to freedom until 1990. Mm-hmm. You still have in Cuba a communist government, even though there have been layers of sanctions since the 1960s. In North Korea, again, a country where we've gone through three generations of the Kim dynasty, and North Korea, despite sanctions by the outside world, has more nuclear weapons and more intercontinental ballistic missiles than ever before. So sanctions, as the Biden administration has admitted, are a long-term approach, but there are only two basic tools to deal with a country that aggresses. One is military and one is sanctions. And the problem is sanctions just take an awfully long time, and time that in the meantime, the Ukrainians will lose a lot of people and the country will face a lot of destruction.
During the Cold War, a huge aspect of U.S.-Soviet relations involved nuclear weapons, whether it was from Russia's joining the U.S. and the nuclear club, to the Cuban Missile Crisis, to arms control agreements. What did Putin's allusion to Russia's nuclear arsenal, what did that say to you? How should we take it?
Well, Putin ordered that his nuclear forces be put on alert. And many in the outside world looked at this as a bluff. It was kind of a scare tactic. The United States has responded, along with most of the West, with kind of cool disregard and has not taken the bait that Putin has put out there. But the reality is one thing that's much deeper, and that is that we are at a point in the nuclear age where there is only one remaining nuclear pact. The rest of them have been abandoned or eroded. And you have a larger nuclear arsenal in Russia than in the United States when it comes to the big kind of strategic nuclear weapons, the kind of thing that you drop in Hiroshima and Nagasaki. Russia has over 6,000 in its total arsenal, not all of them active, but and the United States has about 5,500. When you look at tactical nuclear weapons, which is a whole different category most people don't know about.
These are short range. Short range.
That the strategic weapons you fire from, you know, 5,000 kilometers, 3,000 plus miles. A tactical weapon you fire from 500 kilometers or 300 plus miles. And you usually do the smaller ones at a tank formation to affect, you know, a certain battlefield. But the reality is there's never been a nuclear pact on tactical weapons. And today, because, well, Russia has about 3,000 and the United States has less than 300. And I think the danger is that there's a fear that Putin might use a tactical weapon in some ways to intimidate the West, to again exert himself, his power, to try to prevent the West from doing more, to kind of put it back on the other side or prevent its greater intervention on behalf of Ukraine. And I think that one of the things coming out of this conflict, however or whenever it ends, is the renewed focus on how do we ensure that nukes don't re-enter the kind of current fears of war and weaponry.
Robin Wright of The New Yorker, thanks. And please stick around. We'll see you again in the question and answer session after we hear from our other guests. Thanks. Our next guest is Professor Kimberly Marten of the Barnard College Political Science Department. She's also on the faculty of Columbia University's Graduate School of Arts and Sciences and its School of International and Public Affairs. Professor Martin's current research focuses on Russian foreign policy and security policy. Kimberly Marten, thanks for being with us.
Thank you for having me.
We tend in public discourse, I think, especially about countries we're opposed to merge the country with the leader of the country. So we talk about what Russia is doing in Ukraine and what Putin is doing in Ukraine as though they're the same thing. Are they the same thing? Is Vladimir Putin now the Sun King of Russia, who is the state?
It's difficult to know exactly how the Russian public really feels about Putin in recent weeks, just because there's been such a reimposition of the kinds of controls over media and social media that we saw in Soviet times, and also fears of sending people to prison for saying the wrong thing, even for calling what's happening in Ukraine a war. But I think we do have evidence that it's not just Putin alone, because the evidence that we have of the atrocities that have been committed in Ukraine in recent weeks have involved a wide-scale actions by military forces. And so, you know, we could always say, I guess, that they're just following orders, but it seems like it's going beyond that, because Putin is not controlling every single action that a military person takes on the ground. And so I think what's really happening is that Putin has managed to just inflame a sense of humiliation and anger and rage in Russia, and is putting the blame on Ukraine, saying that Ukraine is a Nazi state, even though its leader is Jewish and had family who were killed in the Holocaust. And as social media and media have shut down, it's harder and harder for people in Russia to learn the truth about what's really happening.
But let's say that the news coming home, because there are losses of lives, or because people phone back, whatever, and the sanctions actually take a bite in some way. Let's say Putin does decline in popularity. Does it matter? I mean, does his leadership depend in some way on public support?
Well, the public support helps make Putin seem uniquely qualified to lead the country. And so it certainly is sort of an arrow in his quiver of what makes him the person who's appropriate as leader. And one thing we have to keep in mind is that even if people turn against Putin, it's very unlikely that we would see any kind of a coup attempt or any kind of an organized overthrow attempt. It's always difficult to get people to act together. But when you're dealing with a very repressive society, where Putin, at least up until the last few weeks, we know has been strongly supported by the intelligence services, who are able to just at a moment's notice release information about people that would damage their career or destroy them, or accuse them of a crime that would put them in prison, or as we've seen, even commit murders against people who are Putin's opponents. It would take an enormous amount of bravery for people to come together, and an enormous amount of trust among people who don't normally trust each other, that they were actually acting in concert and that somebody they thought they were working with was not actually a spy for Putin trying to prevent them from acting. So even losing popularity isn't going to cause him to necessarily lose power.
We hear a lot about Russia's oligarchs and Putin's cronies among them. Can you explain who empowers whom in this relationship? That is, does Putin rule in part thanks to the wealthy few, or are the few wealthy because Putin rules?
It's a very complicated relationship. There are certainly people that Putin has made wealthy who did not start out that way. He replaced many of the oligarchs that were there in the Yeltsin era with people that came from his own background in St. Petersburg, Leningrad, and in the KGB, the intelligence services. It's the case that he gets money from them, that he probably takes his little bit off the top of whatever it is they earn from their contracts. But at the same time, it's not like these people are, for the most part, genuine, you know, great capitalists and great business people. They rely on the special arrangements that Putin makes for them in order to have their businesses prosper. So they need each other very much.
Yes, when you say that he replaced some of the earlier oligarchs with oligarchs for his liking, it sounds like you're talking about cabinet positions or you know, semi-official roles in Russia.
There's not really so much of a distinction between some people who are in cabinet positions and some people who are the leaders of state-owned enterprises, people who are in charge of privately owned enterprises still very much have Putin's close ear. And so it's a complex relationship, but it doesn't look much like what we think of in a normal capitalist system.
I've read that you've been engaged in a counterfactual exercise, asking what would have happened if NATO had not expanded to include Poland and the Baltic states, that is Lithuania, Latvia, Estonia. Have you reached an answer to your counterfactual question?
Well, you know, I'm an academic, and so we never like saying yes or no definitely about anything. It always, it depends. But the conclusion that I came to is that there was so much going on that made the US, Russia, and Western Russia relationship difficult in the 1990s, that we can't really say that it was NATO enlargement that was primarily responsible for the kind of anger that we've seen. And in particular, people who were analysts in Russia, very qualified analysts, understood that NATO enlargement, especially after the first round, as it got larger and larger, actually in some ways weakened NATO in its ability to carry out military activities. There's no evidence that Russia felt particularly militarily threatened by what NATO did. It didn't expand its forces on NATO's borders. And so the conclusion I came to is that what Russia really felt about NATO enlargement is that it was a symbol of how Russia's status in world politics and in international security was falling. And so it contributed to a sense of humiliation in Russia, I think much more than to a real sense of threat or of military concern about what was happening.
Humiliation is an important principle here, and it's a national sentiment, or it is something that Putin feels profoundly, and he's been able to spread the idea around.
Well, you know, in the 1990s, things were very hard for Russians in general, and there was a tendency to blame the West for what happened in Russia in the 1990s, whether that was fair or not. There was a sense that Westerners were profiting off the misery that Russians were feeling after the collapse of the Soviet Union. And I don't think it was necessary that Russia would move in the direction that it did, but I think Putin was very smart in capitalizing on that. He was really a policy entrepreneur who could take those feelings of disenchantment and humiliation and a feeling of not being accepted by the West and turn it in a direction where by the time that he took over Crimea in 2014, you had people out in the streets cheering that Russia had gotten back property that originally belonged to it.
Well, Kimberly Marten of Barnard College in Columbia, stick with us for the Q&A session, and thanks for being with us today. We're going to turn now to Ivo Daalder, who is president of the Chicago Council on Global Affairs. He's a specialist in European security, and he served during the Obama administration as U.S. ambassador to NATO. In the late 1990s, he served in the Clinton White House as director for European affairs on the National Security Council staff, where he coordinated U.S. policy on Bosnia. Ivo Daalder, it's good to talk with you once again.
Well, it's great to be here. Thanks for having me.
You wrote last month in Foreign Affairs about the return of containment. In the late 1940s, when the U.S. diplomat George F. Kennan proposed that policy, it meant a policy aimed to blunt advances by the Soviet Union, but it didn't include overt efforts to push the Soviets back out of countries that they occupied at the end of World War II. What does containment 2.0 mean?
Well, it's pretty much the same as 1.0. It's providing for a counterforce capability to contain, make sure that, in this case, Russia does not expand further than it has already expanded. And by that, well, means no further than its own borders. And that one uses a combination of political, military, and economic instruments as a means to raise the price for Russia for continued attempts to expand. So what does that mean practically? It means severe sanctions that are being implemented and a slow but certain decoupling of the Russian economy from the global economy. We're a long ways there with only, although significantly, energy still to go. And the Europeans who are most reliant on energy imports from Russia are accelerating a very rapid transition away from reliance on Russian oil and gas. Just taking Germany, oil imports from Russia have declined by 50%. Gas imports have declined from 40 to 25%. Coal imports, which are about to be banned, have declined from 35 to 25% just in the last 6 weeks. And that is for the largest consumer of Russian energy costs. Militarily, it means standing up NATO's capacity to defend its territory now further east. This is already starting to happen. There's a significant buildup of NATO forces in the east. That is likely to continue. And politically, it means looking to isolate Russia politically as much as possible. That is happening in some cases in the UN and in other cases through a diplomatic effort to create distance between Russia and its partners and non-partners around the world.
You know, when Kennan first proposed containment in a foreign affairs, it was then quarterly, I believe, foreign affairs article, he wrote that the main element of that policy, and I'm going to quote here, would be a long-term, patient but firm and vigilant containment of Russian expansive tendencies. You've talked about containing Russian expansive tendencies, but what about the long-term patient and firm and vigilant part? Is America ready for the long haul here in the policy of trying to contain Russia?
Well, we'll have to find out whether they are. Of course, we were for 40 years, and it took 40 years to implement Kennan's policy. And at times we didn't quite implement. We went off the deep end, whether that was on Vietnam or other places. But it took 40 years. I don't think it's going to take 40 years to create the kinds of pressures that would change the internal dynamics of Russia. Russia today is nothing like the Soviet Union. It is an economy the size of Canada's. Its military, as we see, has some significant problems, particularly of fighting a combined arms kind of operation, which it hasn't really done since World War II, showing not to be capable of doing. And the combined power of the West is significantly greater than that of Russia was than was true at the beginning of the Cold War. So I think the reality is that a strategy of containment, a return to containment, is likely to lead to the kind of internal fissures that we've seen successfully lead to the end of the Cold War in a much quicker way in Russia.
What do you say, though, to the argument against sanctions? Robin Wright told us about the many countries that have been sanctioned, and it's been many, many years in some cases to see some results. In Cuba, the embargo becomes the explanation for everything the regime has ever gotten wrong, that it's always the fault of the embargo, you hear. How effective can these sanctions actually be?
So in Cuba, the problem is that there's only one country sanctioning Cuba, and it is not a widely used part of the instruments of countries around the world. In this case, it is 60%+ of world GDP that has combined in sanctioning Russia. It will take time. And the purpose ultimately is to make sure that that in the first instance, the expansion tendency now in Ukraine and in other parts outside of the Russian state are stopped, halted, and not gone further. What happens to the regime internally is, you know, we all want to see some change over time, but is less important than that Ukraine, frankly, Moldova, Georgia, other parts of the former Soviet Union that are now independent, remain independent, remain sovereign, that their territory is theirs, that their borders are respected, and that they can decide their own political future, basically act like normal states, which Russia is trying to prevent.
One other question, does the fact that Ukraine has been willing to talk about neutrality in what some, but they've been peace talks of some sort, does that mean that Ukraine ultimately has to acknowledge that it has to in some way bend to the desires of its big neighbor, Russia?
I don't think so. I actually think that the neutrality discussion is making clear how dependent, in fact, Ukraine will ultimately have to be on having security guarantees from its neighbors. And whether that's through NATO or some other matter is really actually just an organizational question. When Zelensky and others are talking about neutrality, they also are talking about security guarantees that are even more significant than those NATO countries receive as being members of NATO. That is a guarantee that countries will come to the direct defense of Ukraine should it once again be attacked. That's what Article 5 under NATO foresees. And so I think we're going to end up with...
Didn't we already guarantee that to Ukraine?
We assured it. This is the difference between guarantees and assurances. But you're right. In 1994, the United States spent a significant amount of diplomatic effort to convince Ukraine to give up the nuclear weapons that were on its territory when the Soviet Union broke up. Mm-hmm. And in return for which, Ukraine insisted and got security assurances from the United States, from the United Kingdom, and from Russia, that all three countries would recognize its sovereignty and independence and the borders as they then existed, which, by the way, included Crimea as a part of Ukraine. Of course, that was violated in 2014. And I think history will look back and ask the question, what if the kind of response we are launching today with regard to the to Russia's invasion of Ukraine had been launched in 2014, would we actually be in the position that we are today?
Ivo Daalder, thanks. And we'll be right back to you in a few minutes. Rounding out our panel today is Donald Jensen. Dr. Jensen is the director for Russia and Europe at the U.S. Institute of Peace. For those of you, by the way, unfamiliar with the Institute, it describes itself as a national, nonpartisan, independent institute founded by Congress and dedicated to the proposition that a world without violent conflict is possible. Don Jensen served as a U.S. diplomat for many years. He was involved both in negotiating and implementing arms control agreements. He was in Russia, in Moscow, during the very eventful early 1990s. Don Jensen, we're very happy to hear with us and have you with
Thank
us today.
Thank you for having me.
You were an eyewitness to events in the early 1990s, the collapse of the Soviet Union, the failed coup against Mikhail Gorbachev by KGB hardliners, then the crisis where Boris Yeltsin sent troops against a recalcitrant parliament. You saw the end of the Cold War up close. Can you imagine a return to anything like the Cold War?
Well, first of all, I did indeed watch it at front hand with the tanks in the mud and the cold rain. And I can remember looking at that new Russian flag fluttering above the what they call the Russian White House, thinking we had won, that this was a democratic breakthrough. And in fact, it wasn't. This was the era of the end of history. But I think we misread what went on inside the Soviet Union as it declined, as it broke apart. And this, I think, set in train a series of, let me say, unwise policies that continued for much of the 90s. And I think, as Robin said correctly, and I think Kimberly as well, that it embittered a Russian population that unfairly blamed the U.S. for a lot of their misfortunes. And that set the ground for Putin taking advantage of that as he began to have Russia's muscles flex again. Is it the same as the Cold War? It's very, very different in key ways. Number one, I don't think Putin has an ideology. Yeah. I think he's a nationalist. People talk about his desire to reinstate the Soviet Union, and I don't think that's the case. He's trashed the Bolsheviks in two major articles in the last year. He's a Russian imperial nationalist. And thus the problem in many ways is that, if I can use a political science word, the strategic culture that Russia has about itself, which seems now with their reduced economy, unable to fit into a more globalized world, even if it's a multipolar global world.
Then help us see the world the way you figure it looks to Vladimir Putin. Is it a place that has unjustly deprived Russia of what Russia by rights is entitled to, for example?
It has indeed. I think he wants to restore Russia's place in a almost said Kimberly multipolar system, but I don't like to use that word, in a world that is more accommodating for Russia's natural interests. Russia, in his view, is an exceptional nation. For a Russia that is able to dominate its neighbors, and they can live with the U.S. preferably diminished from what it is now, but the U.S., China, Russia, that's how he sees the world, and he sees the system as unfair to Russia, and thus what he's trying to do is retool the system or destroy it or replace it or reform it in a way that allows Russia to pursue its greatness. I would say in many places where the Russians are active, it's almost a pursuit of chaos for strategic gain, because he knows if he can undermine NATO, if he can undermine the U.S., if he can send nasty disinformation narratives to the West, in many ways that compensates for Russia's comparative weakness, relatively, in the military area. And now we've seen problems in Ukraine. So this is a major challenge, I think, to what Putinism has evolved into over the last 20 years. We have to now sort it out and see where we go next.
We heard Professor Marten talking about her academic exercise of the counterfactual, what if NATO hadn't expanded? And she said, well, things were pretty bad anyway. But if I'm hearing you, if NATO had decisively shut the door to Ukraine, deferring to Russian anxieties, you think our relations with Russia would have been very different? If we told the Baltic republics you should be Finlandized and be part of neither bloc?
No, I agree with Kimberly. I was in Moscow at the time, where even Foreign Minister Kozarev expressed interest in Russia eventually joining. Mm-hmm. The NATO expanded, yes. I think its aspiring members were nervous about their big neighbor for good reason. But I think the West took very seriously what might be called potential Russian concerns. There was a NATO-Russia Council. They took very, very much care in not doing things that were provocative to Moscow, and it didn't work. So I think the problem is deeper than NATO expansion. After all, NATO didn't attack Russia for 20, 30, 25 years after it expanded. So I think this, to some extent, is a narrative that Putin uses for a variety of purposes. And unfortunately, it has a lot of people who now say they subscribe to it. But I think it's a much more complicated set of decisions by the West at the time than the Kremlin lets on.
Having made the decisions that were made, and now where we are now, looking forward, do you see some containment-like regime as the next policy toward Russia that should evolve?
Well, I'm a great admirer of George Kennan, but I think that I like Ivo's comparison about the time frame, 40 years. It will be less, but I think one of the problems is that Russia is more difficult to contain now because it has all these other, if I can use the H word, hybrid weapons, hybrid instruments to influence a U.S. election, maybe, or a French election, or to give arms to Serbia or places like that. So these things can be done much cheaper than building up a massive military machine, which they've tried to do anyway. Mm-hmm. So there may be leaks in the strategy of containing Russia. Certainly it's an admirable goal, but I think we have to think about what is containment in a different way.
Well, I think we're going to talk about that now. Don Jensen, I want to bring back our entire panel, Robin Wright, Kimberly Marten, Ivo Daalder, and first, I'd like to hear, starting with Robin Wright, from what you've heard from your fellow panelists, are there any important points that you'd like to either endorse or dissent from? Robin, anything you'd like to?
I admire all of the other panelists and endorse everything they've said. I think that one of the things that's important for all of us in looking and picking up from where Don was, is the repercussions of this globally, that this, the stakes here have never been just Ukraine. It was always that broader relationship between Russia and the West, but it's also about the balance of power. And when you look at who are the winners and losers out of this, you know, don't forget China. And China's not putting on sanctions, and Xi Jinping, who has, you know, this broad vision outlined all the way through 2050, you know, is not spending money on arms for Ukraine. And whether this is the kind of thing that empowers his ambitions or endorses his ability or just strengthens China as the one that's not, you know, involved in this costly, tragic war, that we need to kind of begin thinking about how does this world look like? How does it shake out after this war? And I think there are going to be a lot of things that it could be very different, looking at whether it's a stronger West, but the fact is there are deep fissures in the world. When you look at who is not participating, Brazil and India as well, that Brazil, you know, and again, this is another issue of the what impact this has on the kind of global economy and the supply chains. Brazil gets a huge percentage of its fertilizer from Russia and Ukraine, and Brazil is one of the great agricultural exporters. India gets so many of its arms from Russia, and it doesn't want to penalize. The United States in the last 10 days has spent a lot of time and energy as dispatching diplomats and making calls to Indian politicians. There are many countries in Africa, including South Africa, which have said, we're either siding with Russia, or we're not going to join sanctions, because they get arms. And they also remember Russia's support for some of the, you know, the wars for liberation or the anti-apartheid movement. So, you know, I think that when we talk about this question, we tend to get so kind of caught up, and I think it would behoove us all to think big about this as well.
Kimberly, Marten, sure. Thoughts of what you've heard?
Sure. I just want to say one thing about nuclear weapons. I was actually heartened to hear that there seems to be less information getting back and forth to Putin about what's happening on the battlefield, because I think that means that there might be a screen of military officers between him and military decision making. And I think it's very unlikely that military officers from Russia would want to introduce nuclear weapons to the battlefield, just because for so long it is something that everybody has understood just has incredible dangers that go along with it. But what I'm much more concerned about is the possibility of the use of chemical weapons. Mm-hmm. We know that the Biden administration has been warning about this for a while. And I was very disturbed to see in today's Russian news headlines that the Russian Defense Ministry has claimed that Ukrainian defense forces or specialists are planning a provocation of using chlorine gas in Kharkiv. And that very much worries me, just putting it into the context of what the Biden administration has said Russia might do in terms of trying to blame Ukraine for a chemical weapons attack that it itself used, especially because Russia looked the other way when its close ally Syria repeatedly used chemical weapons, including chlorine weapons, on its own population in Syria. So I would just raise that concern.
And Ivo Daalder, any remarks?
So three quick points. One is, Kimberly had the counterfactual about what would have happened if NATO hadn't expanded. I think there's another counterfactual we should be playing with. What if NATO had expanded to Ukraine? Would we be where we are today? And I think that answer is becoming increasingly interesting to look at, and also about what will happen after the war with regard to Ukraine. I think Robin is exactly right on the larger global impact of this. This is not happening just within a European sphere. It is a larger sphere. And the impact on China is going to be very interesting to watch. On the one hand, it could be that the Chinese see the United States caught into a European security problem, therefore lessening the involvement of the United States in its own region. On the other hand, they ought to be pretty worried when they look at how a top-down military relying on Russian weapons is performing against what really is a ragtag army in Ukraine, and say, wait a minute, where did we get our weapons from? And how is our NCO officer corps here when it comes to thinking about the PLA? And then the Actually, those were my two. There was a third one, the chemical weapons one. Yes. Kimberly is exactly right on the chemical weapons issue. I think the administration is extraordinarily concerned that something is going to happen. I hope that within the NATO construct, we are spending a significant amount of time thinking about what we would do in response. Mm-hmm. Because this does change, as both Biden and Stoltenberg, the NATO Secretary General, has said, the way one thinks about this war, and in my view personally, the likelihood of an actual military intervention by NATO or NATO countries in this conflict goes way up if chemical weapons get used.
And Don Jensen?
Two points, really. First of all, maybe a historical footnote. I remember 2 years ago, I think Kimberly was at the constitutional referendum, and I saw a couple Russian press items that there was a significantly higher no vote to Putin in the military, particularly in the strategic rocket forces, in that summer as COVID broke just before the military exercises. That doesn't mean there's going to be a coup by the military. It doesn't. But I think we have to be careful not to paint the Russian domestic scene with one color. But Kimberly, again, this issue of public opinion and what does it mean, that's one of the most frequently asked questions. It's extremely difficult to answer. What's Putin's rating? It's sort of the cliche. Mm-hmm. And I tell my students at Hopkins that I think public opinion in some ways plays a different role in that system. It legitimates the rule of the authoritarian leader, but it does not exercise the kind of constraint on the actions of the Kremlin that it might here or in a Western democracy. And that's very troubling because to some extent, as somebody said, his rating is what it is. It's pretty high. We know it's lower in Moscow, but will that make a difference in terms of popular reaction to Ukraine? I doubt it. I wish it would, at least for now. Maybe the mothers of these poor boys who are being sent there will act, but I don't see much sign of it at all.
Well, I wanted to pick up on what we've just been talking about in terms of chemical weapons. And Ivo Daalder said that it would, if there were indeed a Russian use of chemical weapons in Ukraine, that would lead to rethinking NATO's attitude toward intervention in Ukraine. And all of you, I mean, none of you said, I think the policy right now with Ukraine should be send the troops in and don't don't be cowered by Vladimir Putin, as some Ukrainians tell Americans. What would happen if NATO responded militarily, or whoever wants to answer this? What should be, should there be a, hate to say it, red line, Kimberly Marten, that says, if you did that, our reticence about entering the war would diminish a great deal. What do you say to that?
I'm very concerned that if NATO were to get directly involved in the war in a way beyond providing weapons and providing other forms of assistance, that then Robin's concerns about the use of nuclear weapons by Russia would go way up. I think we know that the Russian doctrine says that nuclear weapons can be used first in the event of an existential threat. Given that Putin has promulgated this idea that Ukraine is part of Russia and that it doesn't deserve independent statehood, I think if we had some kind of direct NATO intervention in Ukraine, that could become something that was interpreted as an existential threat to Russia. And I'd be very, very worried if that happened.
Does anyone else want to comment on that question? If not, we'll Robin Wright.
So the interesting thing is that our intelligence was so extraordinary in understanding the buildup. Where we got it really wrong, because we didn't want to provoke Putin, was we didn't understand how bad the Russian military would perform. Mm-hmm. And I think if we had known that in advance, we would have done much more earlier. But remember, it was rallying our allies and it was trying to prevent a provocation that that Putin would use to justify an invasion. But if we so overestimated the Russian military's capabilities, believing they could conquer Kyiv in a couple of days, 72 hours, what we did was based on that. The other thing, and I want to pick up on if NATO does get involved in the nuke issue, One of the interesting things, I talked to a four-star general about this issue, and he said he once wore the key around his neck for, you know, if they had to verify, and he did the Russians for 10 years. And he said, in the immediate aftermath of World War II, because we had used the bomb, we spent a lot of time investing in nuclear issues, while as the Russians really invested in conventional warfare. But with the end of the Cold War, it flip-flopped. And the US, because we were in fighting small, or, you know, not the big power wars, we were fighting, whether it's in Afghanistan, Iraq, that we worked much more, invested more in conventional warfare, while the Russians really invested. They never changed. They kept going on their nuclear. And as a result, they have a capability. And we have that sense of that in the West, look, we use them once, we never want to use them again. But the Russians, as Don pointed out, have a very different approach. And if they want to, and they've done the unexpected, and Putin in his strange, you know, evolution might yet again do something unexpected if NATO gets involved. And that's, you know, that just changes the ballgame.
I want to, yes.
Robert, just on this, because I mean, this is critical. And we can't walk away from it because it's very uncomfortable to think about it, because we are in a situation, it seems to me, that is more dangerous than any other situation we've been since 1962. But we also need to learn the lessons from that, it seems to me. This is a two-part game, if you want to look in old game theoretical terms, which is how nuclear strategy evolved in the 1950s. And it's not, it doesn't only have Putin who has the ability to use nuclear weapons too. We do too, and he knows it. Our nuclear weapons may not be as nicely tailored to the kind of strategies that the Russians may think, but they're pretty darn good. They still have big bombs, and a use of a nuclear weapon would change things in a very fundamental way, and so would the use of chemical weapons in a fundamental way in this conflict in Europe, and so. It is easy for us to be self-deterred. By the way, it's why we didn't enlarge NATO to Ukraine, because we were afraid that the Russians might be upset. Turns out that was a major miscalculation on our part, as even the Germans now agree. And so I think we need to be very careful to say, oh my God, that means World War III happens, and therefore we shouldn't do anything, because that basically opens up the door to the other side, to the old madman theory, to be the madman in order to generate strategic advantage. And so we got to be careful about this and really start having a discussion about it that even in which I hope is happening within governments, because we better start thinking about it.
This is a question from Paolo Manso, who's listening. No Latin American country, he writes, has sanctioned Russia until now. Why, in your opinion? There are still 11 countries in Latin America without a U.S. ambassador since more than 15 months. Some very important countries such as Brazil don't have a U.S. ambassador. How can this be explained? Does anyone have any thoughts on sanctions Ukraine and Latin America?
No. Well, I made my point about Brazil. I will say that there are a lot of countries that don't have U.S. ambassadors yet, and that's where you get to Congress. The fact is, we didn't have an ambassador in Ukraine either.
Good point. Although
I would be the first to blame Congress for anything, but let's be clear. We don't have an ambassador because we haven't nominated one in Ukraine or in Italy. We have in Brazil. There's a problem in the way we deal with nominees, both in the executive branch and in the legislative branch. And I do think having ambassadors makes a difference. It allows you to have the kind of conversations that need to be had in order to remind people why it is important that standing up against a bully like this, who's engaged in the kind of behavior that we just saw and see daily on our television screens, requires one to take some steps.
Another question related to the nuclear issue, thinking more globally, is concerns Iran. Given the explicit or implied Russian nuclear threats, this Joel Schwartzman asks, How can the United States consent to any deal that would enable Iran to achieve its own nuclear capability? I mean, does this, let me put Mr. Schwartzman's concern more broadly still, does this change the way we approach a question like Iran? Do the events that have occurred in Ukraine alter our calculations at all? Don Jensen, do you have any thoughts about that?
I don't think that it does. I think that there, Mr. Schwartzman raises a very good question, but I'm not sure they're comparable in the same way. I would note, however, that the Iran deal is still out there being discussed and negotiated. And I think some people in the administration want to be less than they harsh on Russia than they usually could be, because they think that Russia's assistance is needed to get that deal. I don't particularly like that, but I do think that that's out there in the policy community.
Can I weigh in on that?
Yes, Robin.
So I spend a lot of my life doing Iran. So the Iran nuclear deal is now on the precipice of collapse because they have one issue on which they can't agree. And I know this from, let's say, very good sources. Mm-hmm. But the Iran deal is important in part as it was the most important non-proliferation deal in more than a quarter century. And the fact that Ukraine, you know, gave up its nuclear weapons signals to countries like Iran and elsewhere, you know, it's better to have them, even if just to deter others. So there's an important lesson that comes out of this. The other thing about the Iran nuclear deal is if we get it revived in some miracle, what that will do to the energy markets. And we're talking about 2 million barrels a day that could shift some of the tension, not necessarily for the West, but just in terms of global markets. So there are a lot of, you know, again, this global element, because we are so interconnected now that this Ukraine war is playing out in lots of different ways, that a place like Iran suddenly becomes very important too.
Yeah, I want to ask all of you about this question. You've all talked about Putin as someone who's either an imperialist, statist Russian, or someone humiliated for Russia's loss of stature in the world, or someone who wants to be the next Peter the Great. If so, after Ukraine, who should be most worried that Putin's Russia would do something similar? Or does the checking of Russia's military in Ukraine make people more confident in say the Baltic republics that Putin would be deterred? Who wants to start on this one? Kimberly, Marten, why don't you go first?
There's so many things that could happen next. Moldova is an area that still has Russian troops deployed in it for a long-standing time in Transnistria. That could be something where Putin decides to move. He has unfinished business in Georgia after the 2008 invasion, which put Russian forces permanently in Abkhazia and South Ossetia. But Putin could believe that that's where he should move next. And then, of course, we have an ongoing conflict between Azerbaijan and Armenia in Nagorno-Karabakh that Putin chose to largely stay out of recently when it blew up. But that would always be someplace that he could decide to come in on as well. I think it's less likely that he would attack the Baltic states at this point because of NATO enlargement to include Latvia, Lithuania, and Estonia. Although I think there's some danger there as well because of this little geographic area called the Suwalki Gap between Poland and Lithuania, where you have Belarus on one side and Russia on the other. And we know that Belarus has been directly used for the Ukrainian war. That would be very difficult, not impossible, but would involve high casualties for NATO to defend both by air and sea, and to get land forces in. And so I think that's a possible concern too, but I think it's anybody's guess what Putin would do next.
Don Jensen, what do you think?
I largely agree with Kimberly. I might add Northern Kazakhstan is a possibility, which is more difficult to support, more difficult for the West to defend. But I think it's very, very important that NATO keep together during this crisis, because all my Lithuanian and Estonian friends are very, very nervous. And I think that the Suwalki Corridor is an excellent point, that there's a lot of security hazards there. And I think that what we don't know is whether a diminished economically or militarily Russia will continue to sow chaos for strategic advantage. And that can be done in a lot of ways. I mean, he pulled Wagner out of Libya. He's still in Venezuela and elsewhere. And some of those things to cause trouble for the U.S. can be done on the cheap. You don't need 180,000 members of battalion tactical groups. So how Russia reacts itself to this, with a more aggressively, less aggressively, or aggressive in different ways, is very, it will be very interesting to watch.
Robin Wright, the thoughts on who should be nervous next?
Well, I think we kind of think in terms of countries, and my concern is that that just like the Russians went after this training base in Lviv, that the supply routes, you know, that there's a kind of a spillover, that Russia targets the lanes where the U.S. is transferring arms or where, you know, the Ukrainians are leaving. I think that's very, you know, I think that kind of is like chemical weapons. It's something that could suck us in deeper because they do something that's provocative. And the question then becomes, what does, if they use chemical weapons, if they should target something that's coming across the border, then what do we target? You know we want to retaliate, but what do we retaliate against? And I think that's where it starts getting messy. I just want to make one point about Putin himself. And this is where we talk a lot about, well, public opinion or, you know, how long will he last? And I think, you know, we have to remember that the alternative to Vladimir Putin could be just as bad. And, you know, if someone eliminates him, and also the prospect that anything will happen. My father fought in World War II, and I've just transcribed all his letters. And he talks about all the plots, you know, against Hitler unveiled. And yet, you know, Hitler in the end did himself in, that we have these hopes, but it's the idea that the end of, you know, this long table Putin sits at, that somebody's going to even have a gun that can fire that far, you know, is kind of an illusion. And that I just don't have hopes that this is something that internally we'll see anything happen in a way. And that if there's nothing happens inside Russia, that the dangers for the complications grow with every day of conflict.
And Ivo Daalder, where would you look next, if indeed there is a next act to Putin's restoration, to trying to make Russia great again?
Well, first, I think the person who should be most nervous is Vladimir Putin, because he's had his comeuppance. I mean, we're just about to enter phase three of the war, and he lost the first and the second phase. And I think we need to remember that. Remember, he was going to get rid of the Ukrainian government and basically take over Ukraine, which was going to greet him as liberators in 3 days. That didn't work out. So that was phase one. Then he tried to do it with brute force to take Kyiv. But right now, if you look at the map, there are no Russians north of Kyiv. They are in Belarus and further away. And the Ukrainians won that phase too. Now the war will shift to the east, I think probably, and to some extent to the south, which will place to Russians greater strength, but they are also dealing with morale issues and everything else. It may well be that that even in the third phase, he's not going to achieve what he gets. And then the question becomes, why did we do this? What is the cost to Russia, and how do we worry about that? So if I were Putin, I'd be nervous. Although I take Robin's point that, you know, getting rid of of leaders like that in these societies is really hard, but I'd be nervous. I'm no longer as worried, in part because of what's happened on the military side, that there is another country. I you know, in the beginning of the crisis, I was very worried about the Baltics. And pushed hard publicly and privately to beef up our NATO presence in these countries, as well as in Poland. I'm less worried about that. I'm more worried about what Don talked about, which is the nefarious hybrid activity, the kind of disinformation hacking capabilities that they have shown. I'm very worried about what's happening in the French elections. Just God forbid Marine Le Pen wins that election. You know, what does that do for Europe? What does it do for the strength of the coalition? The EU needs consensus in order to have sanctions. It's those kinds of things that one needs to be worried about. Going back then to Don's point, NATO needs to be united. You know, one piece of good news, it is more united than it's ever been. We're lucky to have a president who understands how to do this, because I think he deserves an incredible amount of support for what he has done, and that's job one.
Well, thanks to all of you. Ivo Daalder, whom we just heard, also Robin Wright, Kimberly Marten, and Don Jensen. Thanks for being, if not terribly encouraging, very enlightening. And many thanks as well to Joshua Plout, Nate Banzani, Ronnie Givigliano, and Andrea Kiss from American Friends of Rabin Medical Center, which produces Global Connection, and our technical director, Sam Lunetta. Our program sponsor is the American Friends of Rabin Medical Center, which is a 501c3 national charitable organization. It represents in the U.S. Israel's largest hospital, Rabin Medical Center, in Petah Tikva, which is in Greater Tel Aviv. The website for the Friends is www.afrmc.org. Join us next month for Extreme Weather Trends with guests Elizabeth Colbert, of the Pulitzer Prize-winning author and writer for The New Yorker, Dr. Gavin Schmidt of NASA, and Dr. Rachel Cletus of the Union of Concerned Scientists. I'm Robert Siegel, and this has been Global Connections, Navigating the New Normal. See you next month. Stay healthy and stay safe.